Jesus é o Senhor.
Jesus is Lord. We came to this conference for the Lord to speak to us. We opened ourselves for the Lord to speak to us. We can only thank God because He has spoken. He not only has spoken, He's spoken, He will continue to speak. We had shared that He is the one who walks among the churches, and consequently, He is the one who knows the conditions of the churches. He knows the condition of the churches. That means He knows the condition of each brother and sister. And because He knows the condition of each one of us, He then writes a letter to us. In this conference, a letter is being written to each one of us who is here. And this letter is addressed to us. It is a letter to the Ephesians. This means that the Lord looked at our condition and said, "You need this." Do you agree with me? We need this letter. This is our need. When the servant of God shared with us, saying that he would speak about the letters to the seven churches in Revelation, we had a concept. He will get the first letter to Ephesus, then the second letter, but he did not walk this way. He told us we need to pay attention to what the Lord wrote to the Ephesians, but not just here in Revelation chapter 2, but what the Lord spoke to the Ephesians in His Word. And it was also spoken to us that we should pay attention to one fact, that He would turn to the seven churches, He would speak to the seven churches, and He began writing to the church in Ephesus. And this has a meaning. This has a purpose. This order is not for no reason. It was shared with us that in all the Bible, we can say there are three letters to the Ephesians. There is the epistle to the Ephesians. There are the epistles for Timothy, who was in Ephesus, and this reflects the condition of that church. And then there is this letter here. Look at God's loving care. This shows us that He worries about us. He doesn't speak just once. He speaks once, twice, three times, and in our case, many times. And it was spoken to us that this church is a representative in that region. We need to see, dear saints, that at God's eyes, this is a church God invested a lot in. It is not a new church. It is not a church that was recently raised. It is a church He had invested a lot in. So He began His speaking to the churches with the church in which He had invested a lot. Tonight, we are many here, and here there are many brothers who are a long time in the church life. I want to know, who here is here for longer than 10 years? Raise your hand. Who has been more than 20 years in the church life? Raise your hand. Who has more than 30 years in the church life? Raise your hand. So, dear brothers, we need to notice one thing. When God speaks, He looks especially at those who are a longer time in the church. Don't think that God here is only paying attention to the younger ones. No! Here in these seven letters, He began speaking to those who were a long time in the church, those He had invested a long time in. I want to ask a question to those who have been in the church life 10, 20 years. Did God invest a lot or a little in you? Now, what does God see after all this investment? What does God see? Are you shining? Are you loving the Lord in a strong way? Are you serving fervently? Or are you at ease still? God invested a lot in us. Is this investment in vain? I'll tell you one thing. If the Lord wrote to the church in Ephesus, it's because He did not give up. He says, I'm going to speak once again. And you can see here, what is the characteristic of this church in Ephesus? In Revelation chapter 2, they do everything right, right? I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. Everything is right. They do everything correctly. They have perseverance. They labored for their name, for the Lord's name's sake. But there is something which is crucial. I have this against you, that you have left your first love, your best love. It's not just a matter of love. In verse 5, he goes on, remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works. That means I would like you to go back to live as you have lived in the beginning. Here he says, you, do you remember? Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works. They lost their light. In the beginning, they had patience and labor. No, but here it doesn't say what it says in Thessalonians. The labor of love, perseverance of hope, the work of faith. Why? Because they lost their vitality. They do everything correctly, but they lost their joy. Tonight, we need to be sincere with ourselves. I lost. Have I lost or not my love, my joy? My joy of serving. Did I lose or not my joy of meeting? Did I lose my joy of cooperating with the Lord or not. We need to be sincere, because the Lord is the one who is speaking to each one of us, dear brothers and sisters. Just as he has spoken to the messenger of the church in Ephesus, you left your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works. I give thanks to the Lord. To our brother, servant of God, when he entered Ephesians chapters 1 and 2, he touched a point which is called grace. And when he shared, I saw brothers, I believe that each brother and sister saw that fueling, abundance of fueling, abundance of enjoyment, the depth of the enjoyment about grace. Did you see that? I saw that. Who enjoys grace this way loves. Who enjoys grace this way has vitality, has joy. Yesterday, we saw an elder of 97 years old jumping. Why? Because he touched grace. Grace is not just a story for him of 50 years ago. Grace is living. Dear brothers, the great question for us tonight is grace living to you? Is it of today or is it of 20 years ago? It's useless to talk about this. The Lord looking, does he see the first love? Does he see the first works? If he does not see this, it's because our experience of grace is of 30 years ago. It's useless to talk about this. This is not doctrine. This is life. This is a living. But I am telling you one thing, dear brothers. God in this conference is speaking to us this word. He is speaking about Ephesians to us because he wants to turn this around. He wants to turn me and you around. How much grace? How much grace? You know, dear brothers, many times we don't say how much grace. Why? Because we think that we're good. Who thinks that you're good? Touches grace very little. Romans chapter 5, verse 20. In the end, he says, where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. Where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. That means, when I see my true condition, when I see that in me, sin abounds, I should touch a grace that abounds much more. Our beloved brother, he spoke one thing that impressed me deeply. He said, who among us is worthy of being sitting here? I'm here. Of course, I'm here. What does that mean? It means that in our brother's perception, just the fact that we are here, this is an immense grace. But we're here, we take this for granted. Oh, well, what's so great about me being here? I came to the conference. That means I am sitting here and I don't touch grace. I didn't touch grace. Our brother sitting here, he touched grace. That is the difference. He can see grace in everything. But we can't see grace in anything. We just complain, we murmur, we condemn, we criticize. We are talking about a brother 97 years of age. For him, grace is recent, it's present. And God is sending us a message. My grace for you is of now, or is it 20 years ago? From 20 years ago. Another aspect, when we think we are good, when we don't see that we are unworthy, that our place was in the lake of fire, we think we're good, the Lord saves us, we don't love the Lord so much. I want to once again touch the testimony of our brother. In his feeling, there is this. My destiny was the lake of fire. He removed me from the lake of fire. Many times, we don't have the perception that we were removed from the lake of fire. Because we think, oh, I didn't even go there. How can I be removed from the lake of fire? Do you understand what I mean? That is why this appreciation of grace is so little. But for who sees, I was there. I was removed from there. I can see the grace abounding much more. And how can I not love a Lord who takes me away from the lake of fire? It's not just someone who stopped me from going there, but he removed me from there. Brothers, there's a great difference. You were hindered from going there, or were you removed from there? This is not a matter of speaking from our mouth. This is reality of the Spirit. So, let us take a look at Luke 7. Luke 7, that story of the sinner who anointed the Lord's feet. The Lord had gone to that Pharisee's house, and there was a sinner who was kissing the Lord's feet and crying and washing the Lord's foot with her tears. And in verse 40, the Lord tells this woman, and Jesus answered to him and said, "Simon, I have something to say to you." So he said, "Teacher, say it." "There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more?" Simon answered and said, "I suppose the one whom he forgave more." And he said to him, "You have rightly judged." Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. So, dear brothers, if you feel that you are forgiven very little, your love is small. But when you have the perception that you were forgiven from many sins, your perception of grace is that grace is so great, and your love, therefore, is so great. If I think I'm good, I will do everything correctly. Oh, the Lord saved me, okay. But my love towards him is not great. Let us go back to the testimony of our beloved brother, the servant of God. When he speaks, and we need to learn with this, this is light for us. I should have been crucified. Lord, you died for me. All of that suffering, Lord, I was supposed to be there. I am not worthy. You loved me. You took my place. Who has this perception? What other way do I have other from loving the Lord? Right? And even more, who has this perception of grace has a perception of the presence. This is a reality of the Spirit. God gave himself to me. This is a present. Look at Revelation chapter 2 when it talks about the church in Ephesus. When he speaks to the church in Ephesus, the Lord identifies himself as the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. Pay attention, dear brothers. The Lord is showing us two experiences, two crucial experiences. First, do you shine or not? Who enjoys grace shines. There is no way. Who enjoys grace shines. Have we seen the light or not these days? I have seen. I saw with my eyes. I heard the testimony of many brothers and sisters who, because of this word of grace being revealed, they said, I was revived. That means they went back to shining. And even more. So look, who enjoys grace shines. And another, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. The Lord is saying, I walk among the churches. Do you see me or not? You know that in the story of the church, there is a servant of God. His name was A.J. Gordon. In the end of the 19th century, he served God. He was a pastor in a Christian group, and that congregation was dead. He would try to do things and nothing would work. Nobody would react. And one evening he was preparing the message and he fell asleep. And he had a dream. His dream is that he was releasing the word, and then suddenly he saw someone coming in, sitting. There was no place for him to sit, and a person gave his place to this stranger to sit down. And he couldn't stop looking at this stranger. And then he said, in the end of the meeting, I will look for the stranger and talk to him. And then he finished his words, he looked for him, and that stranger had went away already. Then he asked a brother who was seated next to this stranger, who was that stranger? And then that brother said, what? You didn't recognize him? No, who was he? He said, it was the Lord Jesus. He was shocked. Then he thought, the Lord Jesus was here? Hearing my preaching? What was his feeling? Was he happy or sad? Did he like it or not? We sang hymns. Did he like the hymns? I wonder if he's coming back. Then he asked that brother, you think he's coming back? Oh yes, he will. He will come back. He will come back. Then he thought, oh, I need to be prepared. And then he woke up. Then he said, he gave the testimony, for the first time in my life, I realized that the Lord's presence is a reality. Now I want to ask this question. You are meeting in the church life in your city. Who meets? Raise your hand. Very good. Do you know that the Lord was present in each meeting? When the Lord was looking at you in the meeting, what would he feel? I want you to be honest. Who sings in the meetings? Raise your hand. The Lord Jesus heard you singing. What did he think of your singing? What did he think of your singing? Did he like it? Or did he say, that's just from your mouth? Or did he say, he sings with his heart. Look, he's singing to me. There's a service in the church. The brothers announce, oh, we have a need of this service. The Lord Jesus is there, paying attention, looking. Let me see who's going to rise up or not. If you could see the Lord Jesus in the meeting, would your attitudes be different or not? Who would have a different attitude? Raise your hand. Be honest. That shows that we know that our attitude is not adequate. For us, the Lord's presence is not reality, it is doctrine. Take a look at Luke 7. Luke 7, it's here. There is a sinner, and then there is this Pharisee. What did the Lord Jesus tell this Pharisee? He said, I entered your house, but you gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. But you did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. The Lord Jesus is in the meeting. I ask you this question. How many times have you kissed the Lord in the meeting? How many times have you gone to hug him in the meeting, saying, Lord, thank you for saving me. Thank you for such grace. I am here full of gratefulness, of gratitude. How many times have you in the meeting said, Lord, I love you. I am here together with the saints. Or are we in the meeting just sitting down? Judging. Ah, the meeting is not good. Oh, no, that brother. Oh, look at that. You say, oh, that brother, look at that. I'll tell you, that brother kissed the Lord. You did not. He cried. He anointed the Lord. You were sitting down. You did not anoint the Lord. Dear brothers, what does the Lord feel today about you? In this meeting, did you kiss the Lord? Did you hug him? Who enjoys grace does this every day, every moment? Dear brothers, the Lord wants to change us. Do you understand why the Lord is speaking about Ephesians to us? Ephesians 1, 2, 3, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3. Are they enough for you to shine or not? Ephesians chapter 1, 2, and 3. Are they enough, sufficient for you to get up? Ephesians chapters 1, 2, and 3. Are they or not enough to cause us to repent? Dear brothers, we are at the age of Revelation. And if you look at the letters to the churches in Revelation, the Lord in all the letters says, I know your situation. It's useless to hide. Dear brothers, dear sisters, it's useless for us to hide. He tells us, I know. And in many letters, he says, repent. Turn back. Who wants to repent and to turn to the Lord in this evening? Raise your hand. Dear brothers, our dear brother, at such an advanced age, last evening, he was in third heaven, wasn't he? Because for him, grace is reality. God's mercy is reality. God's love is reality. And this makes anyone go crazy. Who touches grace goes crazy. This is not doctrine. It's not doctrine that makes us crazy. It's grace that makes us crazy. As I have said in the beginning of the fellowship, the Lord is speaking especially to us who have been years and years in the church life. We are in lack with our Lord. The Lord says, remember, therefore, where you have fallen, and repent and do the first works. Oh, we can create many reasons. Oh, it's because of this, because of that. The Lord will say, the following answer, isn't my grace enough? What else do you need? What else do you want? Do you want vengeance, revenge? Do you want to use your hand? My grace, isn't it enough? Isn't it sufficient? Isn't my love sufficient to you? Because of situations, you hurt me. Brothers, you have no idea how God's light shined upon me during these days of the conference. I am not speaking about a doctrine. I'm giving a testimony of what these messages have caused in me. You know, throughout time, we think that we are better and better. And we start to appear more and more. But if you touch the experience of men of God, of servants of God, you will see that as they grew in life, they would become more and more humble, not more and more proud. I want to give the following example. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 9. He says, for I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Here we see a degree of humbleness. He says, I am the least of the apostles, I am not worthy to be called an apostle. This is humbleness. But did he stop there? No. We can see his testimony farther in time in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8. He says, to me, who am less than least of all the saints, this grace was given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Here, he not only considered himself the smallest, the least of the apostles, he considered himself the least of all the saints. He made him even smaller because he grew even more. Then there's the enjoyment of grace. It increased. Is it the end? No. When he wrote Timothy, closer to the end of his life, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Look, he is saying, I am chief of sinners. It's not just because he would sin less. It's because he saw the true condition. Imagine the enjoyment of grace that he had. I, the main of sinners, the chief of the sinners, was saved. So he touched grace, an immense grace.
o nosso problema é que a gente nós caminhamos na ordem inversa.
Our problem is that we walk in the other way. We say, oh, I was the chief of sinners, then I was least of the saints, but then I was least of the apostles. I'm humble, you see. That means I am someone. Who touches grace says, I am just a sinner who received grace. That is why I'll live the church life in an intense way. Now, let us take a look at Ephesians chapter 4. Verse 1, he says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech to you, who touches? Ephesians chapter 1, Ephesians chapter 2, Ephesians chapter 3 becomes a prisoner of the Lord and a prisoner of the Lord because he touched immense grace. Prisoner of Christ. And then he knows why he was called. He was called for the body. He was called to walk in grace, in love, in truth, in light, and in the Spirit. And he knows that he is with other saints. When he looks at other saints, he doesn't condemn, because he knows I am a sinner who received grace. I am not qualified to condemn anyone. I am not qualified to judge anyone. And I'm not qualified for small little things. I walk with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. I want to once again tell the brothers who have been in the church life for a long time, just as the Lord has given attention to the church in Ephesus, we consider that this church had most time. It's the one that the Lord had invested the most among the seven churches. We don't have here the epistle to the church in Philadelphia in the New Testament, except for Revelation. We don't have an epistle to the church in Smyrna, but we have it to the church in Ephesus. All of us who received an investment from the Lord should go to the Lord's presence. Say, Lord, we should say, Lord, I don't want to know about anything. I just know one thing. I am a sinner who received grace, and I enjoy an immense grace that makes me shine. I enjoy a grace that makes me notice your presence and causes me to kiss you every day in every meeting, which makes me sing to you with all my heart, which makes me serve your children with all love. I'm going to go back to the practice of the first works, because these practices you remember. To go back to this first love, and this first love comes when we touch grace. And we touch grace when we know our condition. Dear brothers and sisters, if the Lord is speaking in this conference and speaking to us, my letter to you are the letters I wrote to Ephesus. Let us take this in a serious way, because the Lord is opening his heart. Let us change. Not forced, but because of love. Not forced, but because we touched his immense grace, which causes us to shine. Amen? Let us now finish. I would like each one to do your prayer before the Lord. I don't know if the Lord spoke to you tonight, but I want to emphasize, especially to the brothers who have been in the church life for many years, the Lord is speaking to us. It is priority for him in this speaking. Let us have 1 minute of prayer, and then we will have fellowship in small groups and help one another to go back to the first love and to the practice of the first works. May the Lord bless us. Amen.